apologies for the late start, but we have the Hillsborough Memorial service outside, so if you understand the late, the reason why we started late. So welcome everybody to the Health and Wellbeing Board. Before we get into the business, I'd just like to, I suppose, kind of formally welcome Eric Robinson, who is the Council's new Chief Executive, who started last week, Eric. Eric's sort of getting his feet under the table and going around to as many different sort of meetings and forums as possible. So it's good to see him here. I think it might be useful just to go around and say who we are for Eric's benefit. That might be helpful. So should we start with Fiona?
Johnson,
Director of Public Health.
Julian Hassel, Director of Children's
Health.
I am Jude
Webster,
Head of the
UK. I'm Richard Crimmins, Head of Building for Energy Signal and Deputising for Andrew Walker, and Director of Office for Life.
And then Robert, it's who is the Action World?
Phil Davis from Health World.
David Allison, World Hospitals.
Paul Wellman, Commission Support Manager for World CCG.
Norma Curry, one of the Commissioning Managers for the CCG.
Anne-Marie Jones, Commissioning Leader, Dallas.
Jackie Edison, Translation Adults.
Phil Gilchrist, Councillor Leader of the Lib Dem Group.
Peter Hill, my time chair, this tells me I'm interim, but
Chris Jones, Cabinet Member for Bath, so it's okay with Public Health.
And Pat Phillips, Committee Services.
And Fisher Chief Director.
Okay. Right, so welcome everybody. Right, so item one is the standing declarations of interest. So I have to ask whether members of the board wish to declare any personal or prejudicial interests in connection with any application on the agenda, and if so, to declare that and state the nature of the interest. So does anybody wish to declare any interest at this stage? Please let us know.
This is our Governor of CWP.
Right. Okay, fine, thank you.
Yeah, I know the CWP.
Okay. Right. Anybody else? No, okay. Right, item two is apologies. Do we have apologies?
Yes, we've got Councillor Jeff Green, Councillor Tony Smith, Paul Murphy from the Sun Bangladesh, and Graham Hodgkins from the Trash and Dallas.
And then that's Andrew Crowshaw from the Nation.
And all their children's is a little bit known to the game.
Okay, thanks for that. So item three are the minutes of the previous meeting, 12th of November, seems like a lifetime ago. Has everybody had an opportunity to have a look at these minutes? Pete?
Just a under 66 second paragraph. I think the comment on there was just out of context, I think back in November now, I'm trying to remember the exact context it was given, but it says, I made a reflection that the submission on the BCF was one in only five. It's not one in five, it was top 20%, and I need the exact definition of what happened there. I'm needing to check it to perhaps support, but with permission, Chair, if that could be taken as a related to kind of the top 20% of acceptance in our Commonwealth County and country.
So can we just agree about the wording that we need?
I'll liaise with Pat, that's fine.
You'll liaise with Pat? Yeah. Okay. Anything else on the minutes that we need to correct in terms of accuracy? No? Okay. So I will sign the minutes subject to that wording change that Pete's referred to. Okay, right, so let's move on then to item four. This is a really important item. It's the peer review feedback from our peer review that we had not so long ago, and it's also particularly looking at next steps. Fiona, will you take us through this, please?
Yes, thank you, Chair. This report really formally acknowledges receipt of the we had from the team that undertook the peer challenge for us in January, and highlights the key recommendations that are made within that letter. It also tries to take the chance to move us a step further on in our thinking about our strategic aims as a health and wellbeing board. One of the key messages from the health and wellbeing peer challenge was the importance of us determining a strategic narrative that would be able to focus our energies and focus our priorities around, and that it's important for us to deliver that. The task for us really as a board is to consider those recommendations and to come to agree our response and the steps that we need to take to reflect our response. And then in terms of our strategy, I think we have a question that is on page 2, under 2.5. We've got a list of some key themes that have evolved from discussions we've had outside the theatre. But the question I have is, are these right? Do these give us a platform for a long-term strategy that allows for us to have a vision of where we want to get to, but also allows us to have some shorter-term wins and some milestones? And I think it would be really critical that we do own them and also reflect where our focus will be within them. Because one of the conversations we've had in previous discussions has been about choosing a smaller number of priorities and focusing all our energies on delivering those priorities and making sure that we are able to have an impact on those. So I think what I would like to appreciate through you, Chair, is if we can first of all sort of reflect on the recommendations and the feedback from the year challenge. Now they are and also the suggested next steps, which are given in Appendix 2 of the report, which starts on page 29. So really just people to give their reflections or any comments in relation to that, and do feel comfortable accepting those recommendations and some of the next steps which are highlighted. And I'd really welcome if there are additional steps that people feel we should take to capturing those now so that we're able to move forward.
Okay, thanks Fiona. So, does anybody wish to make any comments on the recommendations and the next steps that the peer team left us with? Claire?
Thank you, Claire. I really welcome the report, and I think, as I said at the time, this is about holding the mirror up to the work that we've done, and I think the recommendations that they put forward we accepted. The, just a query really, on 2.5 we've got the strategic draft strategic aims, and I did wonder whether 0.6 was a repeat of 0.4. Just a query really, whether that's
something that we could do. I think that's useful. We picked that up a bit more in the next bits of this, so it's closing the in our strategic areas. Can I take from a sort of lower comment that people's comfortable with the recommendations?
Yes. What I was trying to distill, Chair, was if those six statements came from the various bodies who contributed to our work, whether the bodies were willing to give up bits of their statements so that they don't have their bit of the statement set in stone within a sentence, but there's a way of combining the messages from the statements so that they're not identifiable as individual statements but fit coherently together. And for at the moment they read like six things that are linked but stand apart because they're not joined up. I hope that makes sense. One of the reports aims says not a safe place for people to exchange views. I'll try my bit to create a safe place.
If people are happy with the recommendations, can we take that as of the peer challenge, not with our strategic intent? Can we,
I may say, the only thing I was going to add to that, I'm happy with the thrust of these. As we move this forward, it would be good to be clear how will we know when we've done it, and put some time together for somebody who said it isn't just a nice thing to work with.
Yeah, I think one of the sort of underpinning themes of all of the feedback was we need to be able to better measure the kind of added value that this board brings to the whole health and wellbeing agenda in a way that we've not done hitherto, if we're being honest. So I think that's a key for me piece of work that needs to be part of the next steps. And I think the other kind of high-level comment was we've got too many vision statements in the constituent bodies that make up this board. We need one vision statement for Wirral, and also we've got too many partnerships. People, the same people meeting around the same tables on a regular basis to discuss very overlapping kind of themes. So I think in some shape or form, if we can really kind of focus on those kind of three things going forward, for me that was a those three things were clear kind of messages back to us as to how we need to raise our game. Julie?
Just a very brief point, which is the point about language, reflecting the feedback that the team actually gave. I'm looking at Appendix 2 and B. Develop a clear vision with a narrative for Wirral. And I think they use the word compelling. I just think that conveys a sense of urgency and momentum. I just wondered whether that, underpinned by a compelling narrative, can actually be added to the primary aim.
So I mean, without pinning you down to the actual kind of detail, which is like the next phase of this project, if you like, or this piece of work, are people broadly happy with the kind of accepting the recommendations in Appendix 2, which is, I think, what we're trying to get to at the moment? Yes? Yeah? Okay. So, what do we do next then, having agreed the recommendations?
I think that takes us into starting to define that compelling narrative and that discussion that gets into the beginning, which is where we've put under 2.4 a suggestion for a starter for the strategic narrative. And it is taken from the Rural Council corporate plan in terms of it's at the top of page 12 in the papers. And it was a starting point to say, instead of perhaps necessarily sitting in a room and reinventing what we've already spent a lot of time in debating and discussing, do people feel that this actually does describe what we might actually want to achieve as a health and wellbeing goal? And then underpinning it in 2.5, this is being picked up, so I think this is where I think Claire's pointed out that there's potentially a bit of duplication in 4 and 6, and as Councillor Gilchrist says, some of these of 1 to 6 have been distilled from partner organisations' intentions anyway. There's a sense that we want people to feel a connection to what they've already committed to as well. So again, really keen, if we can start from here, and then the next step is to say, well, okay, if these, or where we can ever get to in terms of that discussion, what are the three or four things that we will really use to define our progress over the next year and to set those measures that you were referring to, Phil, so that we're able to say, right, our short-term intent is to have done this in the next period of time, and this will be how we know when we've been successful and what difference we're meant to. And I would suggest that if we can get to the detail of what those maybe there's three or four things that we choose to focus on within these structures, and some of them might be reflected in papers further down on the agenda. So if we're talking about the health and social care system, it might be about our approach to delivering our thinking around the reshaping method, and that would be the key strand of work for that. If we're talking about prevention and helping people to think about what is it, which aspect of prevention do we want to focus our energy on,
and provide that added value, that reason for us all sitting in the room, and something that we can bring and engage with others to bring too, because it's not just about people in this room who are doing this, but it's how do we connect the whole system up to actually doing that. So driven by community needs and where should those points of energy be, and to build some task groups that underpin that, that gives a real sense of delivery. Because one of the things I think we've had is some strategic discussions in the past, but where's the underpinning delivery mechanisms, moving those on and making those happen? So we'd like to construct that around what we want to achieve.
Okay, so let's just pick that for a second. So let's start with the kind of overarching vision statement and the strategic aims, which are set out in paragraph 2.4 and 2.5. Do people think they're reasonable descriptions of what we should be aspiring to achieve? People have any line-up disagreements with any of that? Okay.
Have we engaged around this at all?
Well, I think it would be the starting point of community engagement, wouldn't it? This is capturing what we need
to address. Decimal level those.
David, did you want to say? No. I thought you were gearing up to saying something. Okay. Any other comments on this? Simon?
I don't know when's the right time to play this in, so this might not be, but for me, I think it's about layers. So there is something about why wouldn't we all be signed up to this grand vision for Wirral? But there's something about the Health and Wellbeing Board having a role specifically in relation to health and wellbeing in a sense. And it's kind of making that connection, but also making that distinction, I think, in my mind. So the work that we were in the middle of doing as the peer review came in, to look at our strategic intent, I thought was very compelling. And that we need to make sure we don't lose that, because that came up with those six key areas. And it was the Jane's second name, who came and took us through that. And we all went, wow, that really captures it for us. So whilst we have this overall compelling rural vision, to make sure there's a layer in there so that this is what the Health and Wellbeing Board will focus on to play a key role in that, I think is where I'm trying to get to in that. And I'm happy with that in principle, but as we can take that forward.
Just so people will remember those six key things, which is good. They're about joined up effort on preventable conditions. They're about joined up effort on wider determinants of health. They're about new models of integrated care trying to deliver better outcomes. They're about maximising community assets and resources. And they're about people having more ownership of their conditions and being much more effective for themselves. And then there was a common theme that it needed to be affordable, which that's not what drives me so much. It's just.
So where do those six things fit with the vision and the strategic aims that are set out in this paper for you?
Well, they are.
If we think that's still worth holding on to.
One of the comments was we needed to find a different way of describing those things that people could join up to. I think we've tried to take them from vision statements from partner organisations to try and map them across those key themes. But we could decide that if you prefer those six things, that we just go with those or try and find some language around that. In terms of engagement, I'm not. You know, we're trying to get the balance between having something that gives that compelling narrative that Julia was talking about, and just some statements of the ways we might work. So it's what difference are we trying to make? I think it's in some of the six that are in the paper. The other six, I think, are more about the way we
work.
I think that actually that's probably our describe. Julia, I was going to make exactly that point, the vehicles almost, the handles aren't there, the six points. I
wonder whether some of these could be recast a little bit in terms of actual outcomes. So we're describing something in terms of more people but more older people live well at home in the community for longer. That's articulating that very well, but in terms of actual outcomes, which we can then measure, in terms of, reduction of people, older people being in hospital for long periods, as the balance tips in favour of more people being supported in the community and living well in the community for longer. I just wonder if there's some slight recasting of some of them, so there's something really tangible that we can feel and get quite excited about as we start to look at our performance indicators and see if there's actually a shift.
I think that's one of the important things that came out when talking to the peer reviewers, really, was that we didn't have measurable outcomes. You know, we really need, don't need to set specific goals that we can say that in a year's time, we do know whether we've made a difference. And that's why the health and wellbeing board should be reviewed, isn't it? It is to actually make that difference. So that in, whether it's 1 year, 5 years, 10 years time even, we'll actually have done something that has really made a difference, because these are really lovely statements and nobody could disagree, I don't think, with any of them, but it's having those outcomes to know whether we're doing anything, isn't it?
If I could just chip in. I think these are put forth as strategic aims, so they're draft strategic aims. They're going to be big, bold statements. There are some very big, bold statements, like, you know, no child in rural will live in poverty. And if we kind of hung our coats on that as we will achieve that outcome, I'm not being cynical, we're going to be very disappointed. But it doesn't make it wrong. That is what we should aspire to, and we can measure and performance match our way, right? To sensing if we're making progress against that. So, I mean, I'm quite comfortable with these, as you say, as a starting point, further engagement, further iterations. I think the overall strategic statement, I think, because very often health and wellbeing boards get boxed into the care and social care business. But you've got a good connection there with, you know, economic wellbeing and employment. There's all sorts of spin-offs for, you know, financial well-being, mental well-being, etc. So I think it's a good starting point. So, you know, I'd be happy to just move forward from this point and understand there are other conversations to be had.
Okay, so I'm conscious that we could spend a huge amount of time debating all this. If the broad thrust of the vision statement, the strategic aims are okay as a start of the 10. It seems to me that the next stage is then to try and, you know, take your point, Chris, how do we then translate these strategic aims into something that's kind of measurable, that we can then use as a way of tracking the performance, if you like, as a health and wellbeing board. I think that's where I want to get to, really.
And I think that's something that has come out of that discussions we've been having over the last few months, that need for tangibility and delivery. One of the things I'm keen for us to get into the discussion about is moving beyond those statements of that, well, okay, and what? And therefore, what do we need to put in place, or what have we already got in place, that would enable us to deliver some of that? So, for example, if we had, if we're thinking about children and poverty, where's the right forum and where's the place that should be driven to, and what about it are we going to be focusing on in the first year or so? What is it we're going to stand in 12 months' time and say, do you know what, we all signed up to do X and here we are. We've done it all. But we've actually collectively added value by working together, and I think it's not just about a health and wellbeing board, but it's about the strategic intent flowing through into the work that we do as partners underneath the board as well. And so I think it's really important that we catch capture some things that would be, this is what we will expect reports back on when we meet, and to see the difference that we've made in the way we describe. So in a way we should have a better care for it in front of us today. We expect to see how that's doing and what's the difference that would be. What would be the other things? We talked about things like alcohol and domestic violence in the past. We talked about prevention of gender. We talked about children's gender. What is it? What are the things? So I'm just wondering, as you say, we can have a debate until...
I was going to just ask the question, do we want a smaller group to look at this vision and strategic aims in more detail and come back with some suggestions, recommendations to the full board? I suspect we're not going to crack this today. I'm just trying to think of something to kind of expedite this.
That would be helpful, and what I would welcome is a representation from every department to be a part of that, so that we do get the sense of the ownership, and there'll be different people can bring different strengths in that and different aspects of what we bring in. So if I reach out to everybody and ask for your nominations, we'll meet together and come up with the proposals.
Yeah. When's our next meeting?
We've got a development session.
Is this the kind of thing that would be useful to bring back to the development session?
Yes.
In May?
Yes,
yeah.
And that's what.
Because if this is not our kind of core business, I don't know what is really deciding how we're going to operate.
I think one of the asks of board members is that we try and get a number of things. Take a look at the joint strategic assessment and what our community has told us is important to them. We'll take a look at the discussions we previously had and where we know there are some significant challenges for our community, and then ask people to bring them to the
But can I also ask that we don't kind of reinvent the wheel? So for example, if the Children's Trust has got addressing child poverty as a key aim, then it would be ridiculous for us to come up with a different set of measures than the ones that you're looking at.
Just refreshing strategy and the strap line is poor children don't become poor adults. Sits within the Mersey side, child poverty strategy.
Okay.
So it's there.
Okay, so if we can get that smaller group to meet at least once before our development session and bring back some recommendations to our development session next month, I think that would be really helpful. Does that make sense in terms of the way forward? Yes?
Yeah.
Okay. Anything else we need to discuss on this?
I don't think so. Most of the other actions are there. I think one of the key areas it would be really useful for us to think about once we've got to that is how do we carry out the effective communication and engagement? How do we build that? Because again, that was one of the key lessons. And then just finally, we had a very useful discussion earlier this week, around the relationship between the Health and Wellbeing Board, Health Watch, and Health Scrutiny, and understanding those relationships. A draft protocol has been prepared, which we'd like to circulate around to members of the board about the nature of the relationship between those things so that we get it right and we understand how they work with each other. Because we're very conscious that we could get that much more effective in terms of its way of working. So why don't we do it through you, Chair, if I can circulate that around to members of the board and ask you to feed any comments back to me on that draft protocol, and then we can choose to formally adopt it at a later point. But for all three bodies, we've agreed to have that discussion within those bodies and then come back.
Okay, so we'll come back to this at our development session when we've done a bit more kind of detailed kind of thinking around it. And obviously, again, talk terms not reinventing wheels. If there are good examples. various health and wellbeing boards around the country are discussing these kind of issues to kind of sharpen up their sort of role and purpose. Yeah? And I'm sure our kind of LGA colleagues will have a wealth of good practice that we can move those to. Yeah, okay, we are okay on that? Right, so let's go on now to item 5, which is the Vanguard proposal. Anthony, do you want to talk to us about this?
I have the presentation on.
Oh, you do, right. Yes.
Those who don't know me, my name's Anthony Hassel. I'm Director of Strategy and OD at the Hospital Trust. But I'm just doing this presentation today on new models of care, I guess almost on behalf of the whole health and social care community that's been involved in the development of this, the successful application actually that we put to NHS England for the new models of care programme. So I've got 5 or 6 different slides that I'm just going to go through to give you perhaps a flavour and understanding of the proposal that we put together, where we're at, and hopefully to begin that process of engagement that we need to carry forward with all of you going forward as we embark on what I think is quite an exciting programme to be part of nationally. I guess the first thing to say is we are at the very, very beginning of this, and indeed the application for this process was one that we had to go through very, very quickly during the first 4 weeks of the year. And that presented, of course, some challenges to us in terms of engagement, in terms of how we would probably usually like to do these things. And that meant, of course, that we had to do things very quickly, and it means to a certain extent that we've got a little bit of catch-up to do in terms of engaging all of the different partners across the health and social care community going forward. But there is an absolute commitment to do that, and hopefully today is the start of that process. So, where does this sit? Well, hopefully some of you may have heard of the Forward View, which is a document published by NHS England probably towards the middle of last year, and which pretty much tells the story of where the NHS its partners are in terms of their current position, and says actually, we all recognise that given the variety of pressures that we're, the variety of challenges that we face in terms of a population that's getting older, in terms of increasing expectations of high quality and ease of access, that we need to perhaps rethink the way in which we deliver services. But we need to do that in an intelligent and structured way. So the NHS England, Simon Stevens, its chief exec, who personally sponsored the 5-year forward view, pushed out to the NHS and its partners an opportunity to work in partnership with a range of national bodies, the opportunity to start to test out new ways of delivering care across the full spectrum that we currently know care to be delivering, obviously, from primary care through to social care, community care, hospital-based services, and tertiary. So what they pushed out with this was this opportunity to apply to NHS England to be part of this new nationally sponsored programme, which is supported by £200 million of national money to be part of this new models of care programme. And they wanted applications in two broad areas, multi-specialty community providers in the definitions up there, and primary and acute care systems. Now, frankly, when that came out, that caused a little bit of debate around what those two meant and how were they different. And really, they are not very different at all, is the answer to that question. MCPs are around working around community and primary care, particularly working together. And I use the word community care to include all of the services that are currently delivered in the community, both by the NHS, local authorities, and the range of different third sector partners that would do that. But then the PACS model, the primary and acute care system, the key differentiator was that included the involvement of hospitals, but also that it was to be expected to cover a population of around 200,000 plus. So taking those that information on board, we were very clear that in order for us, as the Wirral, as a coterminous health and social care economy, as a health and social care economy that has one major acute hospital provider, that really it seems sensible for us to say that whilst there were real benefits of acknowledging the MCP model, we thought our best fit was around the PACS. And I'm very pleased to say, out of 266 applications nationally, we were successful in our application to be a part of this programme. And these are the other parts of the country that you can see have been successful in this programme. And I'm not sure it's coincidence, but I like it that Wirral is articulated as number one. And that's NHS England's list, it's not my list. And on all the announcements, Wirral is out there as number one. And I like to think that's probably because we were the best one. But I've had no official confirmation. So you can see there's a variety of different places across the country that will be involved in this programme. Interesting, I'll just draw your attention to the fact that West Cheshire are part of the programme for the multi-specialty community providers, and we're already starting to talk to them as to how we might learn together as part of this programme, given that we are neighbours and have some things in common. So I think it's a real boon, and it says a lot about the partnership working that we've taken forward, particularly over the past 18 months, 2 years, under the Vanguard of Vision 2018, that we have been successful in being what are now called vanguard sites for the development of new models of care in the health and social care system. So, what are we proposing to do? Crucially, what we're proposing to do is to build on all the great work that we know has been delivered over the past few years, and particularly as we've started to develop systems of integrated care. So it's all about using the organisational intelligence, the development of integrated care that's happened, and I'll talk a little bit more about that. But it's got a subtly different and, we think, interesting angle to it, which is also about building on the quite advanced state of the use of technology that both the hospital and primary community services, and indeed in other parts of the system, already deploy. So we all know that across a whole range of different industries, the use of technology is becoming much, much more important in how we efficiently deliver care, both for users and providers. And what we want to do is to build on the work that we've already delivered around the use of technology, to really imbue that into our new health and social care model. But we also, interestingly, have developed a relationship with an American organisation that are already doing this in the States. And all that is about is learning from what they've done, to be able to understand what has worked, what has not worked, and to be able to then take those lessons and apply them to the very NHS and social care public sector application of that model in the world. And we think that offers some opportunity for international learning, because frankly, we don't think anybody's been doing this yet in the UK. And so that we're frankly not reinventing the wheel on some of these things. But But as I've said, this is about building on the Vision 2018 work that has progressed over the past couple of years, and really building on that constituency-based integrated care model around delivering as much care as we possibly can out of hospital and closer to people's homes. But just let me talk a little bit more about what they've done in the States. And again, this is about learning from this experience and applying it where we can and with a local edge to it in the world. And what they've done in America is started to develop these things called accountable care organisations, which are where groups of healthcare providers come together to deliver care in a much, much more integrated way. And we think that's obviously absolutely in line with the work that we've already progressed. And we think there are some lessons to be learned, as I said, from their experience that we're hoping to be able to translate, both in the way and in which we deliver care, but also the way in which we pay for it going forward. And as I say, what we want to be able to do, and I won't try and explain this very complicated slide, but to summarise what I will try and say is we want to use information that's already shared in lots of ways across different parts of the health and social care system. We want to formalise that sharing of information in the best possible way with all the right safeguards to help both patients and professionals be able to be much more involved in the delivery of their care. And of course, we'll need to do that in tandem with patients, with the public, and with the professionals to ensure that we do it in the right way with the right safeguards. But there is quite a lot of evidence, and evidence that has been dealing from some of the developments in the States, that actually by doing this, you can deliver care in a much more effective way, a much more efficient way, and in a much more involved way, so that patients and the public become much more involved in the delivery of their care. Again, this is not without its very specific challenges, and again, apologies, it's relatively small, but what we've had to do is to set some very clear milestones for what we will be delivering over certainly the next 12 months and onwards after that, because this isn't something, obviously, that's going to happen overnight. What we have been challenged to do, because we do expect to be able to receive a proportion of the £200 million available nationally to enable to support us to do this, is to set some really clear milestones about what we will be wanting to do and how we will be wanting to deliver it over the next 12 months. And our challenge now as a health and social care community is to really step up to the plate to understand what these deliverables are and how we are going to work collectively. Obviously with the right levels of engagement, particularly with patients and professionals, to start to develop these new models of care. And we've set out a whole set of deliverables that obviously we're going to be looking to work towards. So next steps, we're busy working now on preparing for a visit from NHS England at the beginning of May, at which they want to talk to us more about our plans and proposals, and hopefully there'll be some of you involved in that visit as we take it forward, and particularly as we have some of those discussions. And at the same time, we're starting to think quite quickly about what type of resource do we need to help us to develop this model. And so almost putting an ask back to NHS England to say, we're really pleased to be part of this programme, but we need your help and support. And that resource may be expertise, it may be help with where there are barriers and policy constraints that are not enabling us to move forward in the right way. But it also might be about access to experts and others involved in the programme. And as you can see, there's a variety of things happening over the next few. So that's a relatively brief whistle-stop tour through what has been a very detailed and interesting journey over the past few months as we submit our application to the new Models of Care programme and ultimately have been successful in that. But as I say, we're at the very, very beginning of the journey on this, and obviously it'd be really important that we continue to key into you as the Health and Wellbeing Board as we progress both the thinking and the development of the model, but also how the outputs of the model start to deliver.
Thanks, Anthony.
Okay. I'll transfer any queries. Oh, task is now the 5th and 6th of May. Sorry, we brought the updates.
Right, thank you very much. Okay. Questions, comments, please?
I think Anthony has been a great summary, and I think potentially I have to put myself and David on board on this one. I think we can talk about it all day. I'd echo Anthony's comments. This is an absolutely great opportunity for work. I think there's a lot of work went in within a short space of time to try and define the work that we had done and how we could take that forward and scale at pace in order to deliver some great opportunities for our residents. The timescales have been incredibly tight on this one, and that has been a big disappointment in terms of not being able to do anywhere near the level of engagement with partners and support with citizens to be able to understand what this can bring. But I echo Anthony's comment that this is, it's the start of the journey, and there's a lot of co-creation that still needs to go on to define what this means in detail a bit more. Already there's been comments from the floor and questions around this. I think Anthony's commented in relation to a small part of this, and I think, would be a real shame for a loss, which is the link with USA and the learners there. I think obviously we're in the past as suffered from concerns around being engaged. Quite rightly, people are concerned about sexist links with organisations sharing the information, and I think it's absolutely right that we take that slowly and at the right pace and at the right, make sure that we're assuring everyone around the work that's being done there. But there's some really good opportunities. Still, we have such fantastic IT structures as a building, platforms in work. And yet, unfortunately, still simple things within health where a patient would attend an outpatient appointment, and as a GP, I know details of that for some time afterwards. And somebody may come and see me in my GP surgery and attend an A&E appointment and not know the changes in medication and things and the risks that bring in. And I think there's some really good discussions that I think we can have with people relation to that improvement in the future. Well, that's just the start of what the opportunities are that we can bring. So just want to kind of echo that this isn't a USA model. And certainly again, this comments around the accountable care organisation, I think, very early stage as to what that means. I think, certainly the model that we have in relation to the purchase of healthcare services brings challenges at the moment. And I think it's right that we explore how we can work as partners together. So really excited again about the key one for me is that we're really at the start of this. It's we've really got to develop the engagement structure, but we look forward to seeing what this brings.
Good, David.
Yeah, I echo everything, and there's been a lot of really good work on this, which is really nice to see it was recognised. Just for the absolute avoidance of any doubt, when we've talked about this being an opportunity, the NHS nationally and on the world is utterly in a situation where it is not sustainable in its current form. So we have a major burning platform, hence the desire to move at pace both nationally and specifically through these different Vanguard sites. They are being set up to do things as radically and as quickly as possible because the way the NHS is currently is not sustainable. And that's from a quality perspective as well as a financial perspective. nationally, you're looking at our hospital along with virtually other hospital will be in deficit, so we're going to have nationally in 14-15 the scale of the deficit's about £1 billion. If nothing changes, it will be £2.5 billion next year. The figures in Simon Stevens' document that talks about the £30 billion and the level of productivity savings and the gap that all you'll hear on the television every night the various political parties talking about in terms of how much they're going to close, the various bodies that are looking at those numbers are describing them as heroic. So anything that you hear the various political parties talking about, those numbers are the absolute minimum. And therefore change is not, this is not just an opportunity, it's an which it is a great opportunity, it is an absolute necessity. So far this year I've taken a £7 million loan and I've sold a building to Sheena, and I'm asking to the CWP, and I'm asking for distress funding to ensure that we have enough cash to be able to see out 15-16. And everybody could tell their equivalent stories of the challenges that we face within the NHS at the moment. Pete and I and John were in a meeting earlier today in contract negotiations, and effectively we're just arguing about where the deficit sits. What we've got to move to is a sustainable, high-quality health organisation that actually provides really good high quality and is affordable and is re-engineered to be affordable and high quality. And this is what this really gives us a chance to do. So for me, it's an absolute necessity if we're going to have a sustainable healthcare on the wither of the type that the population has come to know and understand. But what this is about population health management. We've got a system that, to all intents and purposes, treats you when you're sick. And that's really expensive as you get more and more elderly people and more people with long-term conditions. What we hope to do through this is to move much more to a system that prevents you getting ill or minimises the impact of the illness to keep you as well as possible for as long as possible. And not only is that really good for us as individuals and a population, it is also more cost effective. And that's going to be the real challenge in all of this.
When I first read the document, I had to check where it dated from, and also the length of time that various organisations have been involved. So I mentioned 25 years in the case of one, but the reference to the American organisation was about 10 years, but I'm not clear whether that's their life in America or their involvement in this country. But I did pick up that all the talk about systems is on page 38 of what we had before, which is about the sixth paragraph down, about the shared, that begins with the shared record. But not replacing existing systems, but integrate tightly with them. And as a non-computer person, you'll forgive me. The last time I went into the hospital, a very kind soul had a file which was about an inch thick of all the things that's gone wrong with me in 25 years, and scrappy bits of paper, or A4 size bits of paper with writing on, with all the different departments tabbed with different colours, which is no doubt parallel with everyone else's around the place. And similarly, I probably think back when the local doctors had a strange size, little bit of envelope with a bit of card, they stuff things in. So I can see in the doctors, what the computer is in front of my doctor, and he's doing big stuff. And I can see in the hospital, you've got files of stuff which people are updating or adding bits of paper to. And getting systems which have been apart since 1948, I suppose, to actually talk to each other seems very important as far as any patient's concerned. What is, I think, the issue here is that because there have been various times when successive governments have tried to launch new ways of doing things, and about a year and a half ago we had blue and white booklets from the health service that had to be withdrawn because it didn't appear to have got to everyone, is explaining to the citizen why it's important that Dr. X can talk to Dr. Y or clinician in hospital X, and that information is shared, and this will actually be helpful and enabling people to capture you. That's, I think, the root of it.
It's not only absolutely helpful, The King's Fund have done a piece of work that says one of the most important aspects or the thing that is to the detriment of good integrated working is the lack of joined up information and data. I think as citizens, we don't really want to see the wire, we just want joined up healthcare. We think we've got a joined up NHS that will just talk and provide services as we need them. But in reality, it's made up of a whole series of different organisations and standalone businesses, and we've got to find a way of making sure it is joined up and the right data is shared so that every single interaction between a health professional and the individual will help in this, so that in future a GP will be able to see exactly what has happened to an individual within the hospital and vice versa, so that there's an opportunity to be able to say, oh, you didn't turn up to your GP appointment, is that something we can arrange for you, or you didn't do this or even that. So it's all about making sure that we maximise the benefit of every interaction to keep people as well as possible and avoid the deteriorating.
Going to be an opportunity for us also to think about how we connect in things like social prescribing, those sorts of things. How do we connect up people's circumstances and the rest of people's lives to their care needs? Because people don't exist in vacuum, for example. And the opportunity is there to look at the whole person and to make our systems work much more effectively together, I think, is one of the potential real gains out of this. And I was remember reading many years ago an article which talked about somebody coming in with a bad leg, actually to hospital. What actually the issue was that the room wasn't safe. They'd fallen, they'd injured themselves. That context was the thing that was the issue. But the leg got treated, and then they got sent back into an environment which meant that they'd be coming back in through the door again. So I think it's really important to do that. And I think the other opportunity we have here is to think about the wellbeing agenda alongside the care agenda. Really, talk about prevention, but I think that probably needs to be more explicit. The phrase that's been used a lot at the moment is the idea of parity of esteem around mental health as well as around physical health, and that importance of that within the person. So, I think there are some real chances for us to think beyond the natural boundaries of working relationships that we've had in the past, to think a bit differently about how we can join things and that way. Where the result is actually something community care need, but actually the cause is something outside. Real opportunity to us to know about that.
Sorry. Very quick observation. Really reinforce what others have already said, that this isn't a sort of a sharp change of direction or yet another strategy with logos and glossy brochures to support it. It's absolutely pushing and reinforcing where we were going anyway through the Vision 2018 process. And if anything, all we've been able to do is hook our wagon onto some real national policy momentum, support, access to the best minds and insight into how to make this kind of thing work. So I suppose it's just a reassurance that it's not yet another thing to layer on top of all the other stuff and all the strategies that we've had over the years. So the phrase has been called previously, vision is vanguard, and vanguard is vision. So just because we've got another thing to put in the glossary of management jargon in the world, be reassured this is the strategic direction we've already spent a lot of time thinking about and forging a sense of direction towards.
Okay, so in terms of process,
to reinforce a bit around the fact that actually this is looking at the whole needs of people, that actually across where we've got. As a CVP, we're very much very involved in the work as are other parts of the health and social care system. So I think it's about actually saying that we're all coming together building on the vision of work with a single focus is how do we improve the outcomes of people in work. So I think it is that bit about actually coalescing everybody around that, which I think is a piece of probably important about the piece of work.
So I was just going to ask a bit of process. So what's the role of the health and wellbeing board in this work going forward?
Yeah, I mean, when Anthony says we're writing as a starting case of this, it's absolutely right. And one of the first things on that list is about governance, leadership, engagement, and if you like, integration with our business as normal as well as the transformation stuff. So it's yeah, very appropriate. I think that here is really one of the first formal outings that Vanguard project has had, because I think it sits absolutely at the centre of what this board needs to be about. I'm sure over the months to come, yeah, you'll be hearing and talking and being fully involved in this. And ultimately, I think being the pinnacle, if you like, of governance oversight and ownership of this project.
So we could look forward to kind of regular backs. Can I just ask also, sorry to be one last question, so 200 million, what will it share?
So that's what we're pulling together at the moment, which is, if you like, a business case which says this is what we think we're going to need. Now, obviously, we'll be pitching for as much as possible, but obviously, there's a £200 million pot nationally.
So we've got to be into that.
As part of making the application, so the document that you've got in your package is the application. What we want, what we've got to the office is to build that into the full proper business case for how this is going to work. It's interesting. I was at Chester this afternoon and talking about how they're doing theirs. They're not doing what we're doing, which is proactively going to the next clinic in England and saying this is the ask. They're waiting to be told. No, I think we're doing it the right way. I think we're saying this is what we need. And I think one of the advantages of the programme is because it is new, and because frankly it doesn't have any rules associated with it. I think that there's some opportunity to learn with the national programme as we learn on the ground, and that is quite an opportunity.
And is the 200 million genuinely new money?
That's what we're being told.
Yeah. We're told so, but I don't think it will be divided into 200 million and spreading out through the developers. It will be very much, there will be expertise and contact people that resource in other ways other than direct financial, which is needed. And once the finance is needed, I do think, you know, we've talked about the engagement that be around this. I think there's some fantastic opportunities around that, driving strategy, changing, you know, restrictions that we have in order to be able to deliver. So I think that there's been some great opportunities other than just finance. But yeah.
But we will need some extra money.
Absolutely. And there's some early points about that being available when these smaller accounts than 200 million, but there's certainly already that some resource will be available.
But that's what we'll be discussing on the 5th and 6th. Maybe we'll have tried to form as best we can our ask that can be shaped with them. But the point you made about a lot of this is about making sure that we've put in place the right double running costs, the right resources, the right expertise, and the right support to do this properly. Because I think everybody's been very committed to the 2018 process, and undoubtedly it's made some progress. But one of the frustrations for all of us has been it was another thing for people to do on top of the day job, and therefore it was really difficult to progress at pace. What we've recognised is that we really need to, and we would expect this to be radically different in terms of seconding people, backfilling people, bringing in some expertise, etc. And all of that is all going to have to be resourced. But that is the benefit of this new programme, and hopefully will be an accelerator.
Well, going back to the strategic conversation we had earlier and the role of relationship people, I think we're just describing this in terms of achieving the change in population governance, you can get the right model, use our resources wisely, and are driven by good and shared information, all things we talked about, I won't rehearse that. Us being able to articulate that in relation to those key components of health and well-being work that we've done previously, us being able to articulate that in relation to that overall vision, then makes that kind of wholly integral. So we don't just come back for a regular report, how's it going? We come back and we say, how's this contributing to that vision that we set out? And I think for me that is another of the step changes where this just becomes the way we do things rather than.
Bill?
Thank you. Just working out time scales, at which point we have, who do people trust is where I start? So if you get a message from the doctor, then you maybe part of a phishing thing about please come in for a health check or whatever. Or you get a message when you're sitting there in the doctor's waiting room on the television screen. Or she will shout if I get it wrong, but you know, we have a strap line that says no decision about me there. And therefore, who are the trusted people to communicate what's going on to our residents, whether it's the doctors or, because the local papers don't circulate that much, because people might look at the websites, at which point are we able to send material which is backed by everyone, which says this is how it's likely to take shape, and this is how we're going to work together, how we're going to share information between us and all our different facets. We need to give some thought to that, what the launch of that will be, when it's ready enough to be spread about and crystallised is the right one.
Anyone help with that question?
Well, varied and different, and you know, to suit everybody's individual needs. I feel as if that is happening. I suppose just to flag up what being said about being a holistic look at people, and the third sector is really active in that early prevention as well, some funded and some not funded. So I would hope that that could be taken into consideration as well, but that's an early involvement.
That's really helpful, and I was just going to offer a little sort of practical insight, which is between Public Health Local Authority and the CCG, we've agreed to actually invest and boost our capacity for an outward-facing communications and engagement function. So you know, we know we need to get better at this, and as you say, it's absolutely at the heart of whether or not this project's going to be successful and relevant and actually address the needs of the people. So we get that. We're putting resources into that.
Okay, any other points? So, I mean, I think recommendation is we note the application for this initiative. And I think just taking up Simon's point of view, we don't just want to see kind of regular reports, because it should be the kind of core business really of this board really. So I think it almost needs to be a sort of standing item, I think, on our agendas going forward. That makes sense. Yes. Okay. Thanks, Anthony, for that. That's very helpful. Okay, let's move on to item 6, Better Care Fund quarterly update. Who's going to do this? Jackie.
Yeah, thanks, Chair. This is a very brief update on the Better Care Fund that we've got in the pack. I'm conscious of that I've got off John May Roll to chip in from the CCG. So in essence, we have done some work in the last few months with the Better Care Fund, and we have done a review of the original schemes. To make sure that they are aligned with Vision 18 and the CCG 5-year plan. and recognising the comments that have been made this afternoon around considerable financial and demographic challenges that we're facing as an economy. As we've previously reported in, we will be performance measured against our ability to reduce emergency admissions or non-elective admissions. We did officially set our target at 5% reduction. Because of the challenging trajectory that everybody's experienced nationally over the last few months, that has been going in the opposite direction from where we want, and because of the financial challenges that we're facing, we have made a joint decision to revise the trajectory to probably a more realistic 3.5%, which is the national minimum requirement by NHS England. That still equates to a challenging target of around 6 avoidable admissions a day on top of the current baseline. There was, and there still is, a national requirement for us to manage our resources through a pooled arrangement between the CCG and adult social care. There has been work over recent months, and we have actually got an agreement on Section 75, which will be hosted by the local authority, but that has been jointly worked up. We had joint commissioning group on Friday, and that should be finally signed off at that point. So that work is now complete, and there will be very detailed monitoring behind that Section 75, and there will be a board overseeing those monies and actually any risks and governance arrangements associated with management of that that pool budget. I guess just moving on to the bulk of the as a consequence of realigning the targets and revising the schemes, I have included a summary just on the first page of that appendix 1. We have got a blown up version on the desk. I'm not going to look at the detail behind it with a reassuring note, it's just that top sheet so I'm just going to make reference to, and also a cross reference with appendix 2. Overall, the pool budget has increased a little from our last report. So we have increased from 33.368 million to just over 35 million as a pooled resource for the Better Care Fund. And we have increased the contingency from 1.78 million to 4.2 to help mitigate against the risk of that performance-related element. Just to draw attention to the revision of the schemes and the direction that we're having in that. On Appendix 1, you have got down there the original schemes and the numbering and the original budgets and resources aligned with those schemes. What we've tried to do is maintain investment in community services, so we have really invested in real alternatives to acute care, trying to really target where we can avoid people turning up ailing and being admitted into acute beds. But we have had to make some finer changes. So Appendix 2 just summarises, as a glance for you, the revised schemes and the revised funding position against them. In summary, what that means is that the CCG have put an additional 1.7 million into the community equipment, the Rural Independence Commission. And that scheme has been re-tendered, and we're in transition period at the moment, that will go live in full by July. And that's a much improved commission, a joint commission across health and social care, to really look at targeting our community equipment resources, assistive technology, falls prevention, falls pickup services. And that should really reduce length of stay in the acute sector and actually stop people being admitted for falls and things like that as well. There's a slight revision in 3A on the third sector spend. There was some in-year efficiencies, so that figure has been revised on the top of the CCG. Care and Support Bill, Scheme 8, that is a mandatory figure from NHS England and was revised downwards to the 929 figure. And that was because we haven't got a prison in Wirral, so the figure was reallocated. C9 Protection of Social Care Services is a minor adjustment there of £100,000 that has gone into the contingency. And then we have a couple of schemes that we have almost reached an agreement on to fund through the System Resilience Group. That needs to go for final sign off with the group next week. but in essence, early supportive discharge, some funding supporting NWAS to try and help NWAS have some additional resources through the green car schemes to help to people not have to go to training. And also an element of the wind suppressor, the old wind suppressor beds, etc. So they are proposed to be funded from sister resilience monies. Need to draw your attention to schemes 21 and 22 that were originally proposed as the specialist alcohol services and the alcohol triage service. We've had to make a joint decision not to move forward with those two schemes. Although we believe that from the evidence that came from the perfect day, the perfect week, we know that people with alcohol issues, there is a number of revolving door people who do turn up at Amy and are admitted. Davey's nodding, and we know that there are wards at Arrow Park who do have people using up beds, and maybe we could support them elsewhere. Unfortunately, the data doesn't give robust evidence around that because of the way we capture and count people being admitted. That's not something we're going to lose. We haven't been able to prioritise it now going forward from April, but we have made a commitment that we will talk to, public health colleagues about the recommission to look at how that can reflect and how we can target that group of people still going into our own part, and also not to lose sight of it as we actually look at how we spend money going forward after this year and certainly within the year. So we will work collectively to look at how we can best target resources for that group of people. And then the last scheme, just to draw your attention to, is this new scheme 26, which on Appendix 1, we've highlighted there in yellow those schemes that we're actually pulling together, things like the ICCT investments, the integrated care coordination teams, the brokerage functions, the investment in seven-day services, etc. Those schemes highlighted in yellow, we're pooling together, and we've got a revised offer in scheme 26. And very briefly, that is about really driving forward at pace a number of investments and services that will work together to stop people being admitted into the acute sector. That is an increase in the investment in intermediate care and transitional care beds. And from September, that will increase by 40. So we go from 70 as a core offer to 110 beds. And that is producing really good outcomes for people. People are getting home and they are retaining their independence, which is really positive. We're also going to expand the current services that are at the moment commissioned separately to have a 4-hour response for GPs and NWAS. That will be an urgent multidisciplinary team response that goes out on a call from a GP or NWAS, goes to the person's home, does an assessment, pulls in the wraparound support that that person needs. That might be therapy, it might be re-ablement, it might be an overnight support, it might be a further professional assessment, it might mean access to an intermediate care bed. So that will be more robustly in place, building on what we've got now by September. We have in place now the brokerage response over 7 days, and we are piloting a up to 72 overnight response, up to 72 hours, overnight service. And that means, again, for GPs, we know that out of hours and at weekends, very often, people are admitted because GPs can't get the response they require. And there's an impact on our own part there. So we're going to make sure this commission is in place and we can put in the bare bones of a service to keep people safe, actually at home, rather than being turfed with a SME. So that's the bones of scheme 26, and that is actually pulling all providers together. That includes CWP, the Community Trust, the DAS provider arm, the independent sector, etc. And also WAS providers as well, and commissioning from GPs. All that comes together and starts to deliver as a cohesive service, which will be fully in place and fully operational by September, ahead of the winds of pressure that we'll face again. So in essence, I'm going to draw breath there. That's an overview of the changes we've made in the BCF. And really, what we're asking today is that Health and Wellbeing Board approve, sign off the proposed changes, the revisions to the schemes, and note that the fact that we have now got virtually there now a Section 75 agreement, and we'll continue to report on a quarterly basis with the performance detail going forward about how we perform against our trajectory.
Okay.
I mean, firstly, it's to express on certainly on behalf of the CCG, but also I think the wider board, and thank Jackie specifically for the hard work. She's been, you know, broader shoulders of taking this forward. And from the first moment I arrived in Wirral, everything I heard about the state of the BCF, all the work that has been done not just the last 6 months but the last year before that, was that it's been really exemplary in terms of how well and cohesively and joined up the collaboration has been between health and social care. That's our personal relationships as much as, you know, organisations. So just want to thank Jackie for everything she's done to get us to where we are. I think as well, in terms of the adjustments that have been brought to the board today, a lot of thought and discussion and really some quite hard choices at times have to be made. I think, you know, we could all really make a compelling case for extra investment in alcohol services, for instance. And I think where Jackie says it's not a kind of a never, it's a not now, and that's as much in order to make this list of investments as real as possible. So everything that would remain on this list would, it's absolutely essential that we actually get on and commission these services, and that we extract all the benefits, efficiencies, and like reduction in demand on hospital services that we possibly can. Because, you know, I forgive David, you know, maybe laughing horribly inside at even the prospect of a 3.5% reduction in non-elective care in the face of the, you know, the significant growth and winter pressures that we've seen in the year we just finished. And yet, much of this is not new money to the system. This is £33 million worth of additional cash just decided what you think should dream up. It is about recycling investments and portion of roughly 82% of health investment to 18% of local authority investment. So some of this has, you know, it's actually got to deliver or we're all in trouble. So there are some of the nice to do things on this list which, for reasons of just protecting our contingency, having a little bit of resilience so things don't, you know, go from the front foot from the get-go. We've had to make some of the adjustments we have. So I really hope people will take at face value the motives, the intent, the real hard work and scrutiny that's gone into this, and really now support the people who have to commission with this fund, make it work, and all the providers who have really got their work cut out to make change happen. So thank you.
Yeah, John.
Which, notwithstanding the issue around really difficult choices, I think we'd be remiss of me not to express some concerns around the alcohol issues, given what we talked about at this board and other meetings in the past about the knock-on impact on the services around the serious abuse of alcohol that's going on.
I think I welcome the conversation actually with Jackie about this, and I think we do need to have one. As you know, we've recently recommissioned the drug and alcohol services on the role of the CRI and the provider. I think we need to have a conversation about that new recommission, their expectations of CRI, and then therefore their input into better care fund and particularly the reduction of issues that they need. So I think, John, we do have a service in the world. This would be an additional service
projects on top of what we've already commissioned. I agree with you, we probably always do with more. I thought we need to have a conversation maybe about how we actually make the system work better.
Sure.
Yeah, it was just really sorry to keep blaming on the answer issue, because I think we'd all agree it is a burden of disease in terms of how we move forward positively for our population. Just now for triage, is that an existing service that's going to be decommissioned?
No, it's an existing service that would continue as the additional funding pushing from the extra post going into that service.
Right.
So, sorry, I beg your pardon, the two bits, we've got the aircraft triage, that element has been, the street, okay, sorry, get the right label. The alcohol triage service is the element that is not going to go ahead with 325.
Right.
But we do have, sorry, I'm getting confused with the labels, we do have, some of the other chunks of services lower down, like the street triage, that will we need to look at how we can best align those with the service as well. And we have put an extra 60,000 into that. So there's an extra post on the street triage which will help put across some of that work, section 136 is concerned.
So in terms of the team that sits in Royal University Hospital Trust AME department, in terms of the early intervention team, is that continuing?
That's continuing.
Right, okay, because that does make a significant difference. To people's outcomes. So that's not what's meant by the alcohol triage.
No, that would be a new service.
Okay, thank you.
Simon, preface what I'm going to say by this is absolutely not about where this money is invested, i.e. which organisations, you understand, etc. Also to say this is obviously a key element of what we're trying to do next year, but we should remind ourselves that there's a whole host of investments that's already in place and will continue in whole range of integrated primary, community and social care services and elements of it. But I want to put into this discussion to emphasise absolutely what Jackie's emphasised, the absolute importance of investing in the capacity and the capability of those community services to make happen the step change that we've just described as part of Vanguard. So it's not about where it gets spent, but actually changing that dynamic and saying you have to be able to build those comprehensive services about people, we have to be able to intercept them appropriately, provide the right care, estimated care, as an alternative to.
I was just going to ask, I was kind of reflecting on that. I mean, there must be lots of overlap between the work we're doing on BCF and the Vanguard initiative that we've just been discussing. Both about new ways of working on new models.
So very, very much, and I think as Vanguard we develop that thinking and those models, BCF is one mechanism by which we get that first in 15-16, we make some of that change happen. Without it, we are not going to make the change happen in the way people use our services currently, which we all agree is not sustainable and is not economically sound.
Okay, Phil, and then David.
Phil, I just wanted some more detail, Chair, on the intermediate care element. Does this mean we have a block purchasing with a selected carefully monitored group of homes or whatever?
It does. We have, at the core, we have four providers and we're going out next week to the tender that commission with a 5-year contract, and we're saying we want between two and four providers really on a neighbourhood-based model.
Okay.
A couple of points, Chair, thank you. I've just reinforced the discussion around alcohol. There are a few things that are distinctive around the world. One of them is the level of alcohol and the impact of it. And we set up the second largest degree of alcohol-related admissions after Glasgow. We did an audit and a third of the people in our hospital have consumed alcohol in the preceding 3 hours. So there is a serious issue, and I would certainly reinforce the comments about making sure. So I don't know the detail of the specialist alcohol unit and things like that, but I think we just have to take that it's a really serious issue for us. The other aspect is the comment about we've downrated the degree of ambition, if you like, from a 5% reduction in non-elective to 3.5%.
just how challenging that still remains. Just for, again, for the avoidance of any doubt, I'm planning for a 3% increase. So, 3% increase, because everything we are seeing is the activity is going up. So even now, we are, as of yesterday, I'm experiencing as much of a demand on my non-elective services as the height of Christmas and New Year. We had 80 breaches yesterday from an A&E point of view. So it's a huge challenge for us as a health economy to get our heads around that. And we're already in the new financial year already, of course, so we're already seeing the activity. So not only do these schemes have to come online quickly, they have to be highly effective. So one of the things that, and I've got to try and plan sensibly to make sure that I'm in a better position with regards to nursing staff and open wards as we move into winter this year than last winter, where we got a surprise at the level of demand compared to where we had hoped we would be. So one of the challenges that the CCG have got, of course, is that they are having to try and play their part in the BCF on funding ways of minimising the demand on the hospital, but it's also under PBR, they're going to have to pay for every patient that comes to the hospital as well. And that's a real challenge for the system. And therefore, we've got to hope that these things are effective, but it is a real challenge, and many economies are recognising that that is really quite heroic in terms of that. And then the only other thing is that recognising that a lot of this is not new money, and therefore, as John says, there are things to be dreamed up. We've got to try and make the very best use of the Better Care Fund to support the changes and the transition we're going, because really there is, it's so difficult, and we've got a group of providers that are either barely sustainable or are not sustainable, and therefore we've got to use the Better Care Fund in whatever way we can to contribute to that.
Okay, any other comments, questions on this? So we are being asked to approve the revised priorities and note the progress and monitoring arrangement with regard to the section 75 of the budget agreement. Are you okay with that? Okay, we're okay with that? Okay, thanks, Jeff. Right, moving swiftly on to item 7, quarterly accountability report from NHS England. Richard?
Thank you. So the report you've got some policies and basically sets out single responsibilities in terms of system development.